there are some really fascinating ways of controlling light. In this episode, let's take a look at controlling light with high voltage and aniseed. The optical properties of a number of materials can be altered by the application of a magnetic field, such as the Faraday effect, or the application of an electric field, for example, the Pockels effect and the Kerr effect. The earliest effect to make use of electric fields was the electro-optic Kerr effect, and this was discovered by the Scottish physicist John Kerr in 1857. This effect, which Faraday had searched for decades previously, is a rotation of the plane of the polarization of light in a material across which an electric field is applied as opposed to a magnetic field. His first experiments were for a solid glass slab measuring 6 inches by 2 inches. Holes were drilled into the slab and electrodes placed inside them. The electrodes were connected to a large induction coil. This is not your regular induction coil, however. If we take a look at the original paper, we can see that John Kerr had a gap setting for the coil of 6 inches and sometimes as wide as 8 inches. This actually equates to a voltage of around 130 to 200,000 volts. I really do love old papers like this. When placed between two cross polarizers, the device could effectively turn light on and off. The Kerr effect has been observed in liquids, and for a while, in early electromechanical television, they were used to modulate light. Kerr cells can switch at extremely high speeds, on the order of nanoseconds, and have been used as a shutter in ultra-high speed photography for photographing detonations and nuclear explosions. Of all of the available liquids, only a very few have a Kerr constant that is high enough to be useful. The most widely used of these is nitrobenzene. Unfortunately, it's quite toxic. As one author stated, apart from its unusually large Kerr constant, not many good things can be said about nitrobenzene. It's toxic to breathe, toxic in contact with skin, inflammable, hygroscopic, and a distressingly powerful organic solvent. The toxicity of nitrobenzene cannot be understated. It will literally try and injure or kill you in a dozen different ways. Prolonged small dose exposure causes central nervous system damage, impaired vision, and liver and kidney damage. Inhalation of vapors can cause cyanosis and in some cases death. The oil can be absorbed by the skin and can cause increased heart rate and convulsions. It can cause loss of sensation and use of limbs and intestinal bleeding. It's a probable carcinogen. It's reprotoxic. This is a particularly nasty chemical, it has to be said. I'm not particularly afraid of working with dangerous chemicals or difficult to work with chemicals, but honestly, I lack the facilities in here to do it safely. Nitrobenzene doesn't appear to be restricted under reach, but it's certainly very difficult to get hold of where I live. It could be synthesized at home, but honestly, I've no intention of nitrating benzene and distilling liquid death. Most transparent liquids and solids exhibit some level of the Kerr effect, although usually it is exceedingly small. There are a number of liquids that will work in a Kerr cell, but almost all of them are toxic, especially those that have the largest effect. Carbon disulfide, for example, used in some of the original experiments, is neurotoxic and causes psychosis. How utterly delightful. Of all of these, nitrobenzene is a de facto standard. It is literally everywhere that you look. I really did want to observe a clear and easily recognizable electro-optic Kerr effect, and eventually I came across this table. This is actually a listing for the optical or AC Kerr constants. However, it seems a reasonable hypothesis that liquids with a large optical Kerr constant might have large DC Kerr constants. Once again, the usual suspects can be seen in the table as having high values, nitrobenzene, carbon disulfide, etc. In this list, one chemical in particular stands out as having a very high optical Kerr constant. This is the chemical anethol. We can see it has a relative value of 9.83, higher even than nitrobenzene at 7.25. Anethol has a structure similar to that of nitrobenzene. We can see that it has a benzene ring with some groups hanging off of it. However, unlike nitrobenzene, this is actually non-toxic. Anethol itself is a large component of the odor and flavor of anise, as in aniseed. It is a colorless, fragrant, mildly volatile liquid. Anethol is exceedingly sweet, measuring 13 times sweeter than sugar, and is often used as a flavoring in liquors and candies. It's only slightly soluble in water, but exhibits high solubility in ethanol. This trait actually causes certain aniseed-flavored liquors to become opaque when diluted with water. This is called the Ouzo effect. Since this stuff is non-toxic, I ordered some to try out in a Kerr cell. Obviously, a Kerr cell is required to test the effect. It is possible to buy these, but they're really quite expensive for what they are. There are plenty of elaborate designs in academic papers, but fundamentally, they're nothing more than a suitable container for the liquid with optical windows into which isolated parallel electrodes are positioned. In order to view the polarization change, we need a pair of polarizers and a suitable high voltage supply to drive the cell. I actually managed to get hold of some anethol from the Ukraine of all places. I bought this from a seller on eBay. I'll put the link in the description down below. I'm not affiliated with them, but they have some interesting chemicals. This is greater than 99% pure, which should be good enough for a Kerr cell demonstration. The melting point of this is supposed to be 23 degrees, but I found that with this stuff, I've got to cool it significantly below that to get it to freeze, at which point it sort of turns into a crystalline, waxy solid. But yeah, should be good enough. I'd be interested to see if it would be possible to actually distill or purify this in some way. Maybe we'd get a greater Kerr effect with it. For the polarizers, I've actually bought an astronomical polarizer. The reason I bought this is because they're already mounted in nice little aluminium cells, which is very, very nice. This thing is actually used for dimming bright objects like the moon, for example, but it's demountable. So I now have two mounted polarizers that I can mount either side of the Kerr cell. For the body of the cell itself, I've ordered a 50mm cuvette off of eBay for about $5, which is very, very cheap. This is just regular glass, it's not quartz, but we've got two clear windows, a 50mm cell path length, and what I've done with this is diamond drilled a hole in the bottom of it here so I can mount in the ground electrode. Here are the homemade electrodes. These are just made out of 10mm square aluminium bar stock. I've taken a file to every single corner on these things to chamfer them, and then I've sanded and polished them. This is to reduce the electric field strength at the edges and prevent premature breakdown. But yeah, the electrodes themselves, nothing particularly special there. In the bottom of the electrode, I have a little hole drilled and tapped. This hole mates up with the hole on the bottom of the cuvette. And the top electrode is actually adjustable and is mounted on this little plastic lid here. Incidentally, this lid is made out of perspex, and this turned out to be really quite a bad idea. It turns out that anethol, and possibly ozone as well, is actually attacking the plastic while the cell's in operation. I've actually ordered some Teflon sheet, so I'm going to manufacture a new lid out of Teflon, but for this experiment today, it'll do just fine. I suppose what you really want to see now is how this thing looks when it's all assembled. So after a little bit more work of building a metal base and turning some polarizer mounts on the lathe and some high voltage electrodes, I now have my finished Kerr cell. You can see the parallel electrodes through the frosted sides of the cell sitting in the anethol. In order to drive a Kerr cell, we need a suitable high voltage supply. This is a homemade power supply I've demonstrated previously on this channel to drive nitrogen lasers, and it's capable of generating up to 45,000 volts. There's a micro ammeter on the front here. This is actually scaled in kilovolts. And so if I turn the power supply on, we can see that the output voltage is about 26,000 volts. If I take the ground lead and approach the high voltage terminal, we'll see some little sparks. The output current is very low. This is deliberate. We don't actually need a lot of current to drive a Kerr cell. For those of you that are super curious, here's the internals of the homemade power supply. Very, very simply, it's a ZVS driver that's driving an old AC flyback. This maybe generates about, you know, 8,000 to 9,000 volts or so. This is then fed into a homemade Cockcroft-Walton multiplier that's been sunk in a mixture of paraffin wax and petroleum jelly to insulate it. The output is fed through several megohms of resistance to ensure that we're not drawing, you know, too great a current off of this thing. And then we've got our high voltage output at the front there. So here's the setup for this experiment. I have the Kerr cell hooked up to a high voltage supply, and right behind it, I have a simple plain white LED shining through it. I have the camera set up pointing right down the barrel of the Kerr cell here, and you can clearly see the LED on the other side. If I rotate the front polarizer, we should be able to extinguish that and we'll see the light disappear. Now fire up the Kerr cell and we'll see that suddenly this brightens right back up again. Absolutely fantastic. You'll notice that when I let go of the high voltage button, there appear to be some stringers between the electrodes. This is some kind of solid material. Not entirely certain what this is, although I have read in the literature that this happens with nitrobenzene if the nitrobenzene isn't 100% pure. So my suspicion is that if we really want to get good performance out of this thing, we really need to purify the solution somehow. Still, being able to turn light on and off like this is pretty cool. I have a laser pointer set up traveling through the length of the cell, and you can just about see the green beam illuminated by all the little bits of grot inside the anophole. I have a target mounted in front of the Kerr cell here, and we can quite clearly see that a significant portion of laser light is actually making its way through the cell. This is mostly because of the scattering that's taking place off of all the detritus floating around in the anophole. That being said, when I turn on the high voltage supply, we'll see that the Kerr effect is really very prominent when using lasers. Look at that. We can actually turn light on and off using high voltage and aniseed. Absolutely fantastic. Using anethole as a Kerr liquid has worked out really quite well indeed, with a clearly observable Kerr effect that is prominent enough to be useful for other experiments. Being a safe substitute for nitrobenzene is a huge bonus. It might be interesting to attempt to purify the anethole to see if there's any improvements in performance, and perhaps build a high-speed driver to see how fast the cell can be operated. As always, a huge thank you to my awesome Patreons, channel donators and subscribers. Your support is what makes science and engineering videos like this possible.